The audio, one of the bugs in OBS is that sometimes it doesn't send audio to Twitch, and I have to turn it off and turn it back on. No, that works. I think they may have fixed it, because it hasn't had that problem since one of the updates. But I used to have to switch profiles back and forth in order to get it to work.
Oh, that sucks.
So, all right. And then Dementia Radio and recording in 3, 2, 1.
Recorded live on DementiaRadio.org, it's the Funny Music Podcast, brought to you by TheFump.com, where you can download new free comedy songs twice a week. Now, here's your hosts, Devo Spice and the great Luke Ski.
Hey, Devo Spice.
Hey, Luke Ski.
We have two sleeps on the show.
Hey, hey.
And members what's it called now?
The Suffolk and Goode Players.
Yes. Dale Leopold Suffolk and Goode. Yes. Is on the Harry show. Chris Mazzalesta might be joining us later. We haven't heard from him.
And we have one more guest. We have Star-Lord the Snake.
Whoa.
Yes.
Hello, Snakey.
A good friend of Santana and mine's, Josh, is over, and he is fixing some broken things in the terrarium. So that's why Star-Lord is out and about at the moment. So... He is a very good boy.
I hope he doesn't constrict your style.
He is a rainbow boa, and he's white, blue eyes, and he's super cute. But anyway, that was what was going on when you called a minute ago. it was like I had him on this hand, and it was like the is it you're ready for the show? And I'm like, yeah, I guess. So anyway, and I'm here too.
Lee, if you're still updating the spreadsheet, be sure to add Star-Lord the Snake to it.
Yes.
Meanwhile, welcome to episode 686 of the Funny Music Podcast for August 10th, 2023. The title of this week's episode is A Worthless Pest, and your job, should you choose to accept it, is to work that into our conversation somehow, and I put it in the chat so we can refer to it later. So, let's do the catch-up thing.
Let's get caught up with what Devo and Luke have been up to since last week, or else Devo, if Luke failed and didn't show up.
Hey, what?
No, he's right.
Wildcard, that sounds like a Twitch bug, not an OBS bug. He says, I wish they would fix the bug where the stream hangs after 45 seconds if you were here before the stream goes live. That sounds like a Twitch problem, not an OBS problem. But who knows? Anyway, Luke, what you been up to?
I I went to Wisconsin for a week, which was cool. And I got to go up to there's a little kind of a cabin thing on a lake up near the Wisconsin Dells in a town called Pardeeville, which is Pardeeville. And went there for my nephew Max's 7th birthday. So that was a lot of fun. I got him a couple of Transformers and a couple of like Mario Kart toys, like one of Mario and one of Peach from the movie, where if you like Polak the car and let them go, they go like that. And turns out that was a good thing to get because the decorations were Mario themed, and the cake made by I think it was his grandma, his other grandma, was basically. The cake was the shape of a figure eight, but they made kind of with like part of a cardboard tube, a thing that looked like a little bridge, and that the cart was, or the track was, the cake was all like dark chocolate colored so that it basically looked like a Mario Kart track, and they bought some other little Mario Kart mini race cars and put them all over the cake and stuff like that.
Nice.
So there was a Mario Kart sort of themed party. So I actually lucked into getting a thoroughly appropriate gift. So that was cool. Hung out with them and my brothers and sisters and my mom and Max's dog, Grizz, who is a wonderful lab. Grizz was like running and jumping off the pier to chase tennis balls and stuff. So that was fun. Went to hang out with with Carrie and Alex Ann. And Alex Ann, based on the puppet ad we had made a couple years ago for the FuMPCast, decided that we should make more puppet ads for the FuMPCast using the two puppets that she had handy, which were a squirrel and a shark. So we made like 6 or 7 different ads for the FuMPcast. I posted 2 of them on the FuMP Facebook page. So if you want to go see them, they're great. At some point, I need to actually make a proper puppet of Alex Ann so that we can start doing those with the actual puppets of you know, me and her and stuff. And speaking of puppets, I went and picked up one of the other FuMP puppets from my sister's place where I have all that stuff stored, and brought it back here to California for a project which will remain, you know, secret, I guess, other than what I just said.
Do you have the other puppet we need for that one handy?
Yes, that one was already here.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, let's see. And then, yeah, I went to dinner with an old friend of mine, and she's a principal at a school in Fort Atkinson, Wisconsin. And she was talking about needing a design for a t-shirt. And while we were having dinner, I pulled out a piece of paper and I just basically really quickly with pencil did a quick rough design of what the t-shirt would be. Basically kind of like, oh, you mean this? There, I solved your problem. You're welcome. And she's already taken that shirt and, you know, you're taking that image and taking it to like a t-shirt place and they've made a proper design for it. So
nice.
Yeah. And, now I've, you know, flew back here and Q-Bert has been super cuddly and at my side all day, since yesterday, because Q-Bert hates it when I go anywhere. So, I've been doing my best today because I had today off to be, you know, there for as many cuddles and stuff that Q-Bert would like. So, yeah. And now that Josh is here working on the terrarium, I'm hanging out with Star-Lord as well. So
nice.
Yeah. And some other stuff that I'll get into later when it's my part of the show. So, yeah. What have you been up to, Devo Spice?
Well, we went to Connecticut last weekend to visit my parents for the weekend, so that was fun. And it was fun, except that I also had to spend a significant amount of time, you know, working on this card attack that's been happening on the FuMP. And it was the type of thing where I couldn't stop it. So I was like, all right. I'm taking the form down because adding the captcha to the form didn't help. I was like, I'm just going to stop this in its tracks. And I took the form down and the charges didn't stop. And I went, how are they doing that? I'm like, and I was like looking all through the site and I'm like, do I have another form somewhere? Is there a form on another site somewhere that I forgot about? Hey. And nothing. It was just yeah, that one form. And I was like, all right, I don't know what's going on. So I was thinking, okay, maybe they've set up their own form on their own website and are charging to my credit card processor, which would mean they have my API key. So I was like, let me change my API key. So I changed it, updated the form, you know, the configuration file on the FuMP with the new API key. And that stopped the attack for 15 minutes. And I was like, well, shit. Not only do they have my API key, they have access to the FuMP website files. I was like, okay. So the entire site's been compromised. I need to fix everything. So I changed all my passwords. I changed the name of the configuration file that has the API key in it. So hopefully, you know, they can't find it if they've somehow, I don't know, put in a backdoor to that file or something. And, you know, so I changed all the passwords and then I changed the API key again. And that seems to have stopped it. So it's been 4 or 5 days now since I've done that. And the bad charges have stopped. So I've refunded everybody who got through. There was about 700 charges I had to refund one at a time. Fun. And I think I have finally stopped it. So now that it's stopped, I will re-enable the form as soon as I remember to. If I remember, I'll do it after the show tonight if it's not too late. And then we'll see if it starts up again, and hopefully not. So, and then
what a worthless pest.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, truly. Truly.
And the other thing I did when I got back from Connecticut is I did some more filming with my acting teacher. One of his other classes is a teen class, and he's doing a series of webisodes with them called Acting Class Sucks, where they basically act like themselves in class, bored, playing on their phones and not wanting to do the acting exercises. And I play the teacher. I don't know why he's not playing the teacher. He is the teacher, but he wanted me to play the teacher. So I play the teacher. So whenever that goes up online, I'll send out a link to it so people can watch it if they're interested. And did I mention previously the McDonald's toy that I got?
No, you didn't.
I got a Flurkin.
Yay! I need to go get one of those.
I saw this. I was at McDonald's and I saw that they have a whole bunch of toys based on the upcoming Ms. Marvel movie, and I was like, oh, that's cool. Oh, that's cool. I was like, oh my god, I need to have that. So. I just went up to the counter and bought it.
The Marvels movie isn't coming out until November.
I know.
Why is the Happy Meal happening now?
I don't know. All I can think of is that, like, maybe the movie was supposed to happen over the summer and it got delayed, but the deal with McDonald's was already in place, and maybe that didn't get delayed. I don't know. But, anyway. So, Dale, what have you been up to?
Hi. Nice to be here again. We've been having fun with the Suffolk and Good Players in our show, my friend Lisa, because for two things. One, we have a new album out. Actually, it's the first, pointed the right way, the first album under the name Suffolk and Good Players. It's called Suffolk and Funny. Get it? I had it upside down. Okay, there we go. That looks a little better. Anyway, Suffolk and Funny.
It's a good quality CD you got there. Where'd you get those?
It is. Boy, there's some guy who just spins them out like it's nothing. It's great. It's awesome. Thank you very much, by the way.
Oh, sure.
For the CD publishing stuff. It was great. But the other fun thing that we did, our cast, we have like 8 people. It varies a bit, but we're all in different states, different time zones. And so we're very rarely in the same place at the same time. But we were the weekend before last, where we had a live streaming show we put on. So everyone came to Virginia, where I am, and everyone except Lisa, who's the show's named after, she was stuck in Texas for various reasons. But that actually, she wrote a sketch that took advantage of her not being there and not being good at math and getting dates wrong and so on. So it was great, great fun. But it was really cool to have all that energy in one room. And I got to do my Elvis impression. And it was good fun. So yeah, that's kind of the excitement here lately.
Nice. Cool.
Oh, and by the way, although we do have, a new song that addresses, that worthless pest, former White House. actually, there is some Trump stuff on this too. So anyway, it's not as political as our old show, The BS to Resistance, but it is there for sure.
Nice.
And The other thing I wanted to point out was, oh, now we have a cat instead of the snake. But if Star-Lord had actually suddenly grown legs, he would have legitimately been a Luke Skywalker. Damn it. Okay.
Anyway. We have now swapped pets so that we have, the closest thing I have to a Flurkin, which is Cubert. He's a good boy. He is definitely not a worthless pest or something close enough to that.
Does Cubert get along with the snake?
That's the funny thing. I don't even know each other knows they exist, because I've had them. I have a video of the two of them where it's like, I'm here holding the snake and Cubert's like there on the floor flopping around like, and I'm like, do you two even see each other? And so they either don't know the other exists or they're both entirely chill with the other being a part of the apartment. So,
all right.
I mean,
then.
The terrarium is in Santana's room and the door is closed most of the time. So Cubert mostly is never in there, but you know, whatever.
So, Mike, what have you been up to?
Oh, I have been up to all manner of music, just nonstop lately. Working on a streaming show I've been doing for about a month now.
How's that going?
It's going really good. I'm enjoying it. I'm getting consistent viewers that come back every week and
cool.
stay for the whole show. And yeah, we have a good time. It's really fun.
I haven't been able to make any of them yet. I've been wanting to. I just haven't been around when you've
yeah,
been
man,
on.
We'd love to have you.
Yeah, where could we find the link to that?
Oh, well, that would be twitch.tv/twosleepsmusic.
Good. Okay. Cool.
Cool.
Yeah, and then been working on some stuff with Jeff Whitmire. Been working on some of my own stuff for a new album. And yeah, just been playing music every day. It's awesome.
Yeah, I wish I had more time to work on music because I need to. And I got music stuff I need to do, but I have other stuff I need to do too. And it's like, then my brain decided the other day, hey, there's a new project I want you to do right now. And I'm like, no.
Just shirk your responsibilities.
Yeah.
You're a musician. That's what you're supposed to
right?
be.
Artist, man.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right.
I don't need to pay my mortgage. I can just blow off my job.
Yeah. It's just that like cute, and I'll let you get by with it. It's fine.
I don't know if you ever saw the documentary about Harlan Ellison, you know, the sci-fi writer.
Yeah.
He was classic curmudgeon. And on his typewriter, he had a quote from the songwriter P.J. Proby. It says, I am an artist and should be exempt from shit. I was like, yeah, okay, good.
Oh, I'm going to put that in my email perfect. Signature at work.
Yes.
So, Mike, you posted a song.
I posted a song. It's
give us a quick
Lehrer
intro.
Song.
We'll give it a listen.
Yeah, it's a Tom Lehrer song. I took a little liberty with the style, and I think it worked out pretty well.
All right, here is The Old Dope Peddler by Two Sleeps.
Come on, get up with me, people. Put your hands together. Get out of your seats. The shades of night are falling. Comes a fellow everyone knows. It's the old dope peddler spreading joy wherever he goes. Every evening you will find him around our neighborhood.
Very nice, and very different style than what I was expecting you to deliver for this project.
Yeah, I was going to go with one of my typical styles, but I thought I feel like the style of this one could actually be part of the joke. So with the whole positive depiction of the friendly neighborhood dope dealer, I thought it would just be perfect with like a inspirational contemporary Christian kind of vibe to it.
Yeah, it totally works. I was just more expecting metal, like the old dope peddler. You know, like, you know.
Maybe I should do multiple remixes.
Yeah, put out a whole EP of like, you know, five different remixes, different genres and stuff.
That would be very Nine Inch Nails.
Yes.
Right. Is this part of like a Tom Lehrer project or various people?
Yeah, the FuMP is putting out a Tom Lehrer tribute album, hopefully at FuMPFest. Nice. Where I am like behind schedule on everything, including organizing this project. But most of the artists have kind of been like, hey, I've been working on this project. When do you need it by? And a few have trickled out their songs to the FuMP, including this is the latest one. Cool. So, yeah, it's going to be fun. So, yeah, Wildcard in the chat says this is a great cover. Mm-hmm, I agree. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Wildcard.
So why did you pick this song?
Well, I'm just kind of,
a fan of drugs,
a fan of drugs. Yeah. So, you know, it was a no brainer. No, I was looking through, all the Tom Lehrer songs and this one just really spoke to me. So I had to go for it.
Have you been a fan of Tom's for a while or?
I've heard little bits here and there, and the stuff I had heard, I was a big fan of. I never did like a deep dive into his discography until this project, but, yeah, dude has just a ludicrous amount of hilarious music.
Yeah.
He's not even technically a musician. Isn't he like a math professor or something like
he's
that?
He's a math professor. Well, he's retired now, but he,
well, right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he plays piano and sings, and so he's a songwriter.
Yeah, but yeah, he just has quite the discography behind him.
It's funny, though, because I've had several of the artists on this project say, you know, you're going to have to recommend a song to me because I'm, you know, familiar with a couple of his songs, but not his entire catalog. So we kind of guided them. And then other people were like, I want this song. This one's mine. You know.
Yep, that was me.
Has anyone done Smut?
I believe Bad Beth and Beyond has claimed Smut.
Okay.
Then when we first started talking about this project, I said, I'm going to do the masochism tango and I got dibs and that's it. And then Devo said, Bonnie Gordon wants to do it. And then I said, like I said, Bonnie Gordon is doing the masochism tango and that's it. And I'll do another song. So I'm doing the Vatican rag because I was raised Catholic. So.
There you go.
I forgot you were doing the Vatican rag. I'm looking forward to that.
That was one of the only things where my dad's musical taste and my musical taste, the Venn diagram, Tom Lehrer and Spike Jonze were the only parts at which they intersected. Everything else was different. But I thank him for that. Because he bought that first like 10-inch album when he was in college in the 50s.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
Yeah,
I discovered Tom Lehrer through the Dr. Demento compilations because we got the first one we got when I was a kid was the Greatest Novelty Records of All Time, Volume 6, Christmas on cassette. And that had A Christmas Carol on it, and which I thought was hysterical, but it wasn't like it jumped out at me as like, I need to learn more from this guy. And then we got the entire box set, which not only had that, it had, I believe, the Masochism Tango and... What was the other one? Was it So Long, Mom?
Well, there were four songs done with an orchestra. There was...
No. I mean, on the Dr. Demento compilations.
Oh.
There was one in the 50s and one in the 60s. The 50s was the Masochism Tango. And I think the 60s...
Oh, Poisoning Pigeons in the
Park. Poisoning Pigeons in the Park. That's what it was.
Yeah.
After hearing those two songs, in addition to the Christmas song, I was like, I need to learn more about this guy. And then I managed to find all of his records at various record stores, you know, used. So I picked them. I still have them. They're right there. And then I just listened to them all and became a huge fan. And it was on, you know, his records were on heavy rotation in my basement when I was in high school.
Yeah, I really enjoyed Ian's rendition of Poisoning Pigeons in the Park. That was cool.
Yes, that's a good one. This is going to be a good album when it's done. I'm looking forward to it. So, what else is going on with you?
I wanted to point out real quick, or show this off. I found this in a record store somewhere. This, from what I can tell, and I can't take it out of the frame to show that part of it, but... according to the messaging, like, or the, not messaging, what am I saying? You know, the text on it, this, I don't know if this is one of the very first printings, but it's certainly one of the early printings of the original Songs by Tom Lehrer album, which, you know, he produced himself. So, you know, basically, Tom Lehrer invented the punk rock DIY ethic. So, you know.
He was the original Fidem.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, instead of a dog, I should have had a caricature of Tom as the logo. Oh, well. Yeah, my, I was going to look really quick. My records are under a whole bunch of stuff I'd have to move, so I can't look right now.
Yeah, do you guys know the songwriter Roy Zimmerman?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I did a workshop with him a few years ago in North Carolina, and he talked about how he would be riding in the car with his kids playing Tom Lehrer cassettes, and, you know, the all his references were like to long dead political figures or whatever, and the other kids, well, who's, you know, who, you know, who is Sheriff Clark, who is, you know, who is I don't know, Wernher von Braun, whatever, and it's just, oh,
Wernher von Braun was, yeah, from Tom Lehrer. Okay,
exactly.
Screw history class, I learned about him from Tom Lehrer.
Yeah, Roy would stop the, well, not stop the car, but stop the song and then explain who these people were, just, you know. And I remember hearing this as a kid and saying, who are these people? And it made me want to find out. That was something that when I write lyric, especially when I wrote lyrics for BS to Resistance, I try to do the same thing, try to throw in all this stuff that if anyone was really interested, they could look up and find out. But,
and even it, like not knowing who Wernher von Braun was,
yeah,
the line, once the rockets go up, who cares where they come down? That's not my department, says Wernher von Braun. Holy shit. I laughed so hard when I first heard that.
And I'm learning Chinese.
Yeah.
But the thing is about Roy is that he and Tom Lehrer ended up being label mates, and they would send albums to new, you know, upcoming albums to each other. And he said Tom Lehrer would write these really detailed critiques. It's like, okay, this song was really good. I think it kind of sagged in the middle a bit or whatever, you know. Imagine getting critiques from Tom Lehrer. That'd be
wild.
Mind blowing. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I once reached out to Tom Lehrer via somebody I knew who knew him. and basically because I wanted, it's like, I knew he was going to say no, but I wanted to reach out to him about possibly, you know, being the guest of honor at MarsCon, because, you know, it's like, I'll never know if it could have happened if I don't ask. So I'm just going to ask. And of course he did say no, but he was very nice. And I also sent, like a link to the song, my song Jello Shots, which is a tribute to him, right, and about the fact that he invented the Jello shot. And he had like wonderfully nice things to say about, you know, about it. So just to know that he heard it and he liked it, just maybe like, yay, you know. So
that's awesome. So Mike, what else is going on with you?
Not much, man. I've literally just been playing music all day, every day.
Yeah, you've been burning the midnight oil with that Jeff Whitmire album, right?
That's right. Yeah, we're getting started hard on that. We got to get his Tom Lehrer song done too.
Yeah, you do.
What's he doing?
I don't know if I'm at liberty to say. He hasn't announced it yet. So. Okay.
All right. You can whisper. No, I'm sorry.
I'll put it in the chat.
There you go.
I forgot what he's doing, actually. Tom didn't do any horror movie songs, so.
I hold your hand in mine.
I hold your hand in mine would work, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. All right. So do you have anything you'd like to plug?
Yeah. Come check out my streaming show. It is every Sunday at 2:30 Central Standard. And it is at twitch.tv/twosleepsmusic. And it's a good time. So come check it out.
All righty. Let's do some news.
This is the FuMP.
I'm the roughest, toughest, gruffest, and when the dang long ear galoot acts up, I've had enough of this. Bladder flat and rising tat hat and all that. And my red mustache and beard are the scruffiness. I reckon y'all better keep back.
Yeah. my horse, tis cakes, them Twinkies, ding dong zebras. These ho hos only like me for one reason, and that's because
I got snacks.
That's the Funny Music Project at thefump.com. thefump.com.
I feel like I'm gonna puke, cause the timeline is screwed. Do I fix all this now, or wait till season two? Been a hell of a ride, but the purpose is glorious.
Multiverse. Funny.
Time for Funny Music News. Something, something, something.
In the news, Max Sabbath has announced a new U.S. tour. The parody metal band will be hitting the road starting August 25th, excuse me, in Chicago. They'll be hitting California, New York, Texas, and lots of places in between. Opening acts will be Cybertronic Spree and Playboy Man Baby. And they're coming to Philadelphia on October 30th, and I emailed the venue about opening for them, so fingers crossed. Not getting my hopes up, but maybe. Um, 2D6 has announced a new Kickstarter for their what they're calling their ninth weirdo album. The album, called Live at Casa Boodog Skull, is 16 tracks, 15 songs, and a musical skit, mastered by Kloffenpop with art by the illustrious George Foster Jr. Songs contain topics like an ode to gatekeeping, a tribute to top men, a sequel song to Pac-Man Fever, and many, many more. They are looking to raise $2,700 and are currently at $761 with about a month to go. So they still have plenty of time. But head over to Kickstarter.com and search for 2D6. You will find it. It'll come right up. The other thing I did over the weekend while we were at the beach is I finally fixed the Safari download bug on the FuMP. So for those of you using Safari, the downloads should work again. Let me know if it doesn't. Fingers crossed, should all work. And speaking of things I'm way behind on, I still need to update the FuMPFest website with the latest artist announcements. No additional news at this point, but go to FuMPFest.com and register for FuMPFest. And the FuMPFest 2021 compilation is now available for sale. You can pick that up. All proceeds go to help offset the costs of running the convention, which are still there, even though the hotel is no longer part of it. All right. Anybody got anything before tour dates? Take that as a no. On Sundays in Nashville, Tennessee, Steve Goody hosting at the Bluebird, although he's in Europe right now, so that's probably not happening. On Mondays online, Steve Goody and Brad Tassel at virtualcomedyshow.com. On the 11th in Las Vegas, Nevada, Bolonium. The 11th and 12th in Alameda, California, Phil Johnson and Roadside Attraction. On the 12th in Metairie, California, Consortium of Genius. On the 12th in Doylestown, Pennsylvania, Carla Ulbrich. On the 18th online, Phil Johnson and Roadside Attraction. On the 18th in Muncie, Indiana, Mikey Mason. On the 19th in Park Rapids, Minnesota, Carla Ulbrich. And on the 20th in Doylestown, Pennsylvania, Carla Ulbrich. All right. Second song of the week. Dale, you're up. Give us a quick intro. We'll give it a listen.
All right. So this is inspired by recent events from a certain worthless pest. And it was right there. It's one of those songs that it just falls in your lap and you just have to do it because it's so obvious. If you don't do it, somebody else will. So it's an update on an old Peaches and Herb number, Re-Indicted, with a slightly different focus.
Here is
go ahead. Nope, it's fine.
All right,
go for it.
Here is Re-Indicted by the Suffolk and Goode Players.
Just a myth on January the 6th. You
I sat here staring at that same cell wall. None of my lawyers would return my call. It was then that I knew they were all in here too. I've lost all my appeal. Hey, where's my art of the deal? Hey, hey.
We don't take cheating, Tiny Valley Knives. It's truth and consequences pay the price. Now it's just like you feared. They gave you 24 years. You should have copped the plea so much for your crime spree.
Kudos on the quick turnaround on this one.
It was extremely quick. I mean, literally, I was watching the news and thinking, yeah, I should write this. And I looked up the original lyrics and did that, sent it off to Chris. Within like, you know, 2 hours, you had the full music tracks. And
then as he does, yeah.
As he does, right. I mean, and like the next morning, yeah. George
Mike, Washington, you have competition with Chris for like the fastest turnaround of music. Fed, so.
It's on.
Yeah. George Washington III and Laurie Firth did the singing vocals. I sang the Trump part, but it was done and out. Like, yeah, in like 12 hours total. It was great.
Yeah, Chris messaged me and was like, hey, we need to squeeze in a FuMP song like really quick while it's topical. And I was like, sure, yeah, we'll do it. And he told me what happened, what it was, and I was like, oh, this is brilliant.
And of course, total attention to detail and all, you know, there's the key change in the right place and the, you know, just really nicely done. So yeah, we had fun. It's like I said, it sort of falls into your lap. Like as soon as I heard that, you know, about Putin being indicted by the International Criminal Court, then I was like sitting in the dock at The Hague, you know, I was like sitting. So it's like I couldn't not write it because it was right there. Fell right in my lap, you know. And we did. And of course, Chris does the Red Army chorus on that one as well. That's good fun.
Yeah, it's good stuff. So, so you wrote all the lyrics to this one, right?
Right, right.
Okay, and you do the Trump voice.
Yeah. And, this past year, well, actually with this, with this album, the Suffolk and Funny album, it's interesting because it is like our fourth album. It's the first album under this name, but really we've done three other albums. And I wrote probably 90% of the lyrics on those. And here I probably wrote less than half because Laurie Firth, one of the singers, has written a lot of lyrics and a couple of other cast members as well. So that's kind of fun to pass the burden around, although it's like, wait, where are my songs?
Yeah, it's fun when you can pawn off stuff onto other people to do.
Yeah, yeah.
I pawned something off onto Mike before the show.
Sort of like Tom Sawyer with the fence. Yeah. Here, you can help, you know, this will be fun. Have fun. Paint the fence for me.
So, like, what are the differences between working on Suffolk and Goode versus BS to Resistance?
The name.
The name is one. Yeah, because it's this. The new show is my friend Lisa, and of course, no one can find it because LYSSA is Lisa.
That's what I was trying to remember at the beginning of the show. For a second, my brain thought my friend Lisa was the name of the new group, and then I was trying to remember the name. My name Lisa,
It's a
test. You know what I'm trying to say?
It's a test. If you really are devoted to us, you would know this stuff. But yeah, no, it's so Suffolk Goode Players is the name of the ensemble. But BS to Resistance was our first show, and then My Friend Lisa is our second one. Yeah, so LYSSA, it's the Welsh spelling, supposedly, although there's not enough L's as far as I'm concerned, if it's truly Welsh. It's a good group, and the BS was obviously very focused on the previous administration, and it had a continuous plot line. We had all kinds of things going on. You know, Mike Pence wearing underwear that shocked him whenever he had gay thoughts, things like that. You know, Rick Perry was secretly working for the resistance, but only when he had his smart glasses on, you know, and otherwise he was dumb as a stump. But both of those, by the way, played by Chris brilliantly. This one is more sketch comedy, so we can have all kinds of different things. We can have commercial parodies, song parodies, and sketches, some of which get political, because what are you going to do? It's also a little more like NPR-friendly language. On BS, we dropped F-bombs left, right, and center. Here, we're trying to moderate it a bit to broaden our appeal and, you know, hook those listeners in before they find out how weird we are.
Do you enjoy one over the other? Do you have a preference?
I mean, I'm certainly enjoying what we're doing now because there's freedom, and there's also, I'm one of four writers on the staff, so that's nice that we can spread those out. With BS, I was writing the majority of it for a while, and then Lisa Graham started chipping in, and Lori as well, and so I ended up doing, you know, less than that. But with this, it's sort of like, okay, I'll get in a couple good sketches. We have a running series that I wrote about the Peanuts characters in high school, in modern day high school. We sort of give them the Riverdale treatment, but it's also mixed in with the German sci-fi show Dark, so that there's...
Oh, I got to get back to that.
Oh, it's, you know, you cannot take a break. You'll pretty much have to start over.
Yeah, I'm going to have to start over.
So complicated with characters going backwards, forwards in time and being somebody else's father, brother, whatever. So we did that with the Peanuts characters. And
wait,
like,
do they sing I'm My Own Grandpa on Dark?
They really should. It would make an excellent theme, you know, kind of a sort of a moody minor key German version. I am my own grandpa. Yeah. But with this one, we have, you know, Pigpen going back in time and actually going to the 60s and becoming the Pigpen of the Grateful Dead, things like that. You know, all kinds of crazy stuff. Snoopy is Snoop, who is actually, of course, Snoop Dogg.
Yeah.
And, you know, flying around on his Sopwithel Kamizzle. consuming peyote buttons from his cousin Spike.
Nice.
We have some fun with that.
Awesome. So you guys just did a live show.
Yeah.
How did that go?
It went very well. I think there might have been a couple little technical issues on the audio that we will clean up and do if anyone actually saw it. The first 5 minutes or so were kind of like not so great on the audio because some equipment had gotten shifted in between our tech rehearsal and whatever. But it was nice, a good experience. First of all, we did it last year, but there were only two of us that were in the studio in Virginia. Everyone else was coming in through Zoom. And this time we had everyone but one in the studio.
Was this for an event?
Not particularly. It's just because it was like, hey, let's do that. We actually got invited by the studio that had done it last year and said, hey, when can we do this again? We found a weekend and it was like, hey, does anyone want to come to Virginia? And they're like, yeah, everybody. So it was great. The other thing about it is with our normal episodes, we'll record all the dialogue, assign the songs, you know, record those. And then I have to like put it all together and do the sound design, the sound effects and all of that. And I can, you know, take my time with that and get it right. But with the live show, you have to do all that in advance and then hope that it syncs well.
Hey, Luke, you're hitting your mic cable or something and it's making lots of noise.
I'm so sorry.
Is
that me or?
No, it's Luke. It's
Luke. Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's all okay. Right. It's still doing it. That's weird. Something came loose somewhere.
Well, we've known there you go. That's screw loser too for quite some time. Oh, there we are.
I'm not okay. Saying it's aliens, but
it could be.
Pretty much, yeah, yeah.
Well, whatever it is, it's, you know, they're definitely a worthless pest.
Absolutely.
We may set a record on this show for most times it's been said. All right. So do you have anything you'd like to plug?
The new album, which you can get at our website, which is the sagplayers.bandcamp.com. And it doesn't mean Screen Actors Guild, although some of us are members. But SAG Players, Suffolk and Good, sagplayers.bandcamp.com. New album's called Suffolk and Funny. And if you want to get one of the three albums from our previous show, that's it. bsdr.bandcamp.com for BS to Resistance. And those are really good too.
Kudos on the name Suffolk and Funny. That was very good.
Thank you. Yeah, it's Karen O'Brien and her guys. That she had the name Suffolk and Good Players. Yeah, you know, she's actually a thespian, a trained thespian. I think I can reveal that on the show. But she she had that name and was like, yeah. That's great. We're using that.
All right. Let's do some feedback.
Making the internet absolutely ridiculous. Dementia Radio.
www.dementiaradio.org. Port 8027.
Please hang up and try again.
This is the part where there's feedback.
Feedback.
Feedback. You know that segment of the show we do about now?
Feedback. Feedback.
Feedback.
Feedback. Hamner Hack wrote... Ladies, gentlemen, and curious onlookers, welcome back once more to the FuMP podcast, The Cylons. Okay. Which is oddly appropriate with the noise that the mic is making. And...
For who could ever learn to love a beast?
Father Beast wrote... Luke, I was just listening to the Toons podcast where you said you went to San Diego Comic-Con and saw the premiere of the Strange New World / Lower Decks crossover. I haven't finished the episode, but did you manage to catch the Babylon 5 animated movie, which also premiered at San Diego Comic-Con? I mean, since you're a B5 fan.
I did not catch that one. I know that it's out there, and I do intend to see it. I've just been busy with a billion other things.
Okay. Check like both sides of your cable because it's still doing it. I don't know. And it does. It's not like. Oh, wait. It stopped. Whatever you just did. Whatever you hit on the floor stopped it. Yep. We're good now.
Okay.
All right. People in the chat are wondering like if the cat was chewing on the cable. But... Yep. All right. Now it's doing it again.
Oh, God damn it. All the fuck.
I think it's the snake.
Moving your monitor just made a lot of noise, so something back there is doing it.
Still doing it?
It was really bad just for a moment, but seems to have stopped now.
All right.
Okay. So, Luke.
Yes.
You posted a song.
Yes. So, yeah. the long story short version for the intro is that this is a song I originally wrote and recorded back in 1996, and it was on my first album called Fanboys in the Hood. And I had always wanted to record a version that sounded much more like the original song, because the version that's on my first album was, you know, based more on a remix of that song. Back around 2016, when FuMPFest was happening, I decided to hire Bonecage to make a new backing track for me that sounded more like the original, so I could perform it live at FuMPFest with Devo and Ian. And now, 7 years after that, I finally got around to recording a studio version for reasons, which I'll get into later, with Devo Spice and Insane Ian. So this is Spam Let the Pork Be Pork 2023 edition.
A song just like Eat It will make a brother really, really hungry. I'ma show you how, so fill up your plate and say, yeah, ooh yeah, yeah, it's gonna be great. Put it in your mouth, move your teeth so you can chew that. Have a second course so you get really fat. Be ruthless, exercise your teeth so you don't become toothless. People who need a cavity search, ow. Peace to the brothers who like Weird Al. The man is making millions, talking about the rye or the Kaiser, the whites of my bologna, Rocky Road, taco, grande, waffles, and lasagna. Addicted to spuds, cause they're kinda like yams, but the stuff I like most is spam!
That came out awesome.
Yeah. One of the reasons it came out so awesome, to start at the ending, is I once again reached out to the amazing Chris Mazzalesta of Suffolk and Good Players and BS de Resistance and Power Salad and a million other groups, basically because I had the backing track from Bone Cage, which you know, sounds like the original Onyx song, but it didn't have any of the fancy schmancy stuff at the end. And I already knew that I didn't want to mix down the song myself, because generally speaking, I don't like doing the final mix downs myself, because I just I'm self-taught and I don't think I'm very good at it. Or more to the point, I know people who are way, way, way better at it than I am, and I would rather ask one of them to do it for me so that it sounds a million times better. So I reached out to Chris, you know, saying like, okay, the vocals are me and Devo and Ian, and then, you know, there's, we do the whole Monty Python bit at the end. And as long as, you know, I had Chris and I knew he had access to the instruments and stuff and that he thoroughly understands, you know, the assignment, you know, is there any chance you could add, because I had also, okay, I'm getting sidetracked. Let me finish one story before I start another. I said, is there any way you could add some of that organ music at the very end for those final four notes to try to make it match, you know, the original album cut of the Spam sketch? And, you know, so Chris also added his own vocals to that to fill out the whole Viking big choral ending and then the final note, so that it sounds so dead on like the original version of the ending of the Monty Python Spam catch. It's like, damn, Chris Metheluson does it again. Woo. So yeah, I mean, the mix on the whole song sounds amazing, as it always does when Chris does stuff, but he just like really helps spike the football at the end of the song. Plus, the other funny thing was, I had already decided and recorded myself being the waitress from the thing going, well, there's eggs and bacon and, you know, shut up and all that stuff. And I ended it with bloody Vikings. And then you sent me in your tracks and you had improvised your own stuff from the Monty Python sketch. And you ended your improvisations with bloody Vikings. And I'm like, it's like, I'm already doing that one. So I, took the other things that you said and I kind of peppered them throughout the song like a pepper pot. Ah,
yeah.
But that was like, you know, basically the song is now much more in line with what my original vision of the song was in 1996. In 1996, the original version, I did the first verse. A friend of mine named Zach Gilly from, Ohio, the Toledo area, his name on the album credits is Surreal, as in S-I-R space R-E-A-R, R-E-A-L, Surreal. And then the last verse was my best friend from, you know, grade school, Jay Styles, Jason Stahl. He did the last verse. So that was the original way it was all done. And then later on, I, you know, kind of felt like, you know, it was certainly, you know, awesome and great for, you know, Fanboys in the Hood when that came out. But, you know, in the years that follow, I'm like, you know what? I would really like to redo it with make it more sound like the original song. I would also like to redo it because I want to do the third verse and not the first verse. So that's when I was like, oh, hey, let's get Ian and Devo in on this and we can Onyx it up and have a good old time.
When we did this at FuMPFest, did I do the first verse or the third verse or the third verse or the second? I think I did the third.
No, I definitely did the third verse. See you later, Josh. Thank you. Oh, awesome. Great. You too.
Maybe Josh, I did do the first verse. I don't know.
Have to re-listen to it, but I'm fairly certain. judging by the notes I had sent you guys, I'm pretty sure that, yeah, in the lyrics I sent you that I had Ian go first, you go second, and me go third. So, but yeah, so, I think in the live version, I also, even though we didn't have the big old, you know, organ track, I still said Bloody Vikings at the end of it. So,
Same. I'm looking at the lyrics from the live version that's posted on the FUMP. So yeah, Ian went first, I went second, and you went third. Okay.
Yeah. So, and that was in 2016 when you were doing at FUMPFest a concert called, what was it called? When We Were Us?
Before They Were Now.
Oh yeah. Before They Were Now. Where various people performed as earlier iterations of their act. And
some Sudden Death songs. Chris Waffle was there, did some Hot Waffle songs. You did some Psycho Potpourri songs. And Paul and Storm were going to do some Da Vinci's Notebook songs, but Storm went falling down the stairs and had to go to the hospital. So,
yeah. So, yeah, my... I originally had, okay, back in college, I did a, I had a radio, like a pirate radio show at my college's pirate radio station done out of somebody's dorm room, where I did a, you know, Dr. Demento style show that I called Psycho Potpourri. And, I always loved that when I thought of that name for that thing. And, I the intro I made for that was like a clip of a bunch of weird sound effects from, like, you know, weird other comedy albums, clips from the Ren and Stimpy show, clips from George Carlin specials of him just like screaming and stuff, with me going, "This is," and then a bunch of weird stuff, "Luke Skis," and then a bunch of weird stuff, "Psycho Potpourri," and then the final notes from Dead Puppies, da, 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 and then Ren laughing like crazy at the end of a Ren and Stimpy bit. So that was, you know, I had that title stuck around in my head since, you know, 1992 or whatever. So when I started making, trying to come up with the idea of like, oh, I want to have a comedy music group with me and my friends, and I was calling myself the Great Luke Ski, but I wanted to have more of a group feel to it. So I ended up calling the so-called group Luke Ski's Psycho Potpourri, which was basically me, Jay Styles, and a handful of other friends from, you know, across the country who I could rope into being involved. Some of them came out to Kansas City to help record, you know, stuff on the album so they could be in backing tracks. I think my girlfriend at the time, Tracy, was on there as well.
It's remarkable how similar our two stories are.
Yeah, yeah. So I did the first two albums, Fanboys in the Hood and Shadows of the Bunghole, under the Psycho Potpourri name. And then when I got to the third album, when I was basically taking a huge step up in quality and production, I decided to just drop the whole Psycho Potpourri thing because I knew I was doing all the work anyway, and also I was the only one showing up at the live shows I was starting to do. So I'm just like, I'm just the Great Luke Ski. That's fine. I'm just going to go with that. So so that's where the phrase Psycho Potpourri came from, for all of that purposes. So, you know, many years later, when I was in around 2010, I want to say, when I started putting my music on Bandcamp, I decided to take all of the tracks from Fanboys in the Hood and Shadows of the Bunghole that didn't get remade on, you know, Carpe Dementia or Worst Album Ever or whatever, and then kind of take all of those and make them into one CD of, you know, all of the other tracks, and just call that CD Psycho Potpourri. So it was a, you know, compilation of stuff, you know, left over from those first two albums. So I sold that CD, like, kind of self-made at home, you know, at conventions for years, and then I was putting stuff on Bandcamp, so I put it on Bandcamp as Psycho Potpourri, like, boom, there we go. So that's, you know, that was many years ago. So now I've been doing this project all year. Oh, geez.
Look what I have right here. I have the two original Luke Ski Psycho Potpourri albums right here.
Open them up so that people can see the inside of them real quick. Just because I want to point out that, here, I'll be quiet so they see it.
So, hey, they look at me. Here's the what the inside looks like. And I'll show you the other one. Here's the inside of this one. I don't know why they're both at 90 degrees. But
so it was because back then you had to order CDs in at least 1,000 at a time in order to get any kind of decent price break. And also because I was, you know, still, you know, like just out of college, and I didn't have a ton of money. So I decided, well, I'll get the CDs printed, but I won't bother making the rest of the, like, you know, inlay cards and stuff. And I'll just make those myself at Kinko's. So that's why the cover, you know, inlay card thing is like just a one photo, a photocopied, you know, sheet of colored paper, you know, with, you know, the same thing on both sides, or, you know what I mean? You know what I'm trying to say? Mm-hmm. It's a double-sided photocopy on a colored sheet of paper that I cut down to the correct size. That's what I'm trying to say. So, yeah, that there were 1,000 made of each of those. So that was, you know, if you have one of those, then you have one of the rare original versions of that. Anyway, fast forward to 2023. I'm putting out my newest album, Needlessly Meta, and I'm finally getting around to using Songcast to put all of those things up on Spotify and Apple Music and Amazon Music and all the other places. And, you know, I've been doing this thing every 2 weeks, you know, going in reverse chronological order. Well, I put Carpe Dementia up, and it's like, okay, what do I do about Psycho Potpourri? Because, first of all, you know, there's like 9 other albums, and or you know, however, depending on how you want to count them, you know, that aren't on the whole Spotify Songcast thing yet. Because there's the full-length versions of Fanboys in the Hood and Shadows of the Bunghole, which made up the Psycho Potpourri album. Then there was, I did an all Star Trek compilation called Trek What You Like that had a couple of sketch tracks on it that didn't end up in other places. Then I had my B-sides collections of What a Ripoff Volume 1, Volume 2, and Volume 3. There were the new editions of songs I made for Greatest Hits Volume 1. And then there was the surprise 40th birthday album that Carrie Dalby put together with Devo Spice and a ton of other people called Worst Tribute Ever. So it's like, do I really want to drop the $20 to put all of those things on Spotify, you know, or should I figure out another solution? So the other solution I figured out was because Spotify has a limit of 40 tracks that you can put on an album.
Songcast
has a limit of 40 tracks you can put on an album. So I'm like, what if I could figure out a compilation of, you know, all of the best things from all of those albums and also omitting any of the things that I think shouldn't be on there for either quality purposes, because I was so young and still figuring this out and I sounded like crap, and or maybe these things won't play so well in the year 2023, etc., because of subject matter, etc. So yeah, so I took those and I just put them all into one playlist of this is what this thing will be, and I decided to call the collection Psychopopery Excerpts and Other Stuff. So I submitted that to Songcast to go on all the places back on, what was the date here? It was back on, July 28th, which was, you know, like at least 2 full weeks ago. So I submitted it. I should say I decided to do the whole spam remake thing, you know. It's like, oh yeah, I've been meaning to record the studio version for years with Devo and Ian. I'll finally get around to doing that so I can put it on the collection in replace of the original, you know, spam track, and just have that be a new thing on the album. You know, not that I'm expecting my fans to, like, you know, attempt to purchase this collection, because they don't need to, because they already have all of those albums, or at least the majority of them, you know. But in any case, they are, you know, this song will be up at the FuMP, and they're all subscribed to the FuMP, and they can get it for free at the FuMP anyway. So, at least during the first month. So, so that was what the point of all of that was. So, did you have any other questions for me about the track before I move on?
No. Okay. I did film myself recording it, and I put up an excerpt on my Instagram as like a story, but I've been meaning to take that footage and put the actual music to it, and just, you know, just for my part of the verse, and put that up to try to promote it a little bit more.
Cool. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Never got
that.
Around to it. I will do that. I'll put it up on TikTok and stuff.
I could also mention that I recorded this track in my new makeshift sound booth. So I'm pretty sure, is this the first? Well, I know I did stuff for, I did some background vocals for one of Jeff Whitmire's songs on his forthcoming album. But this is, I think this is the first of my own songs that I've recorded in the new makeshift booth. So judging by the way the song came out, I think it did a decent job, or at least Chris did a decent job making it sound perfect.
It sounds really good.
So I was going to mention, in explaining all of that about Songcast, is that Songcast sometimes has weird rules, and twice I had to go back and check to see what's going on, why hasn't the Psycho Potpourri compilation hit all these services yet. And the first time was they got a some kind of legal flag on one of the tracks, which was, I did a parody of the Sheryl Crow song All I Want to Do about the movie Pulp Fiction, back in 1997, and it was called All I Want to Do Is Shoot Some Guns. And I'm, you know, it's basically, you know, singing all about what's going on in that film. And in that track, because, you know, they had released a soundtrack album for Pulp Fiction that included Samuel Jackson's entire reading of the Ezekiel 25:17, you know, the path of the righteous man, etc., etc. So I had sampled throughout the song that entire thing, so you hear the whole thing in the song. So that song got flagged as being the property of, you know, whatever music company, because of that soundtrack album. So I'm like, okay, crap, what am I going to do now? And then I realized, oh, wait, here's what I'll do. I'll take the version from Psycho Potpourri, from that, off of the collection, and then I'll add to the collection Beth Kinderman and the player character's cover of that song. at the end of the album with all the rest of the worst tribute ever stuff, so that the song is still on the collection there. So that was how I beat the system, man. So then the second thing was that they didn't like it's like, so that went through. It's like, okay, you know, I'm waiting for it to be approved. And then it wasn't until the 6th, which was 4 days ago, I found out they didn't like the way I had some of the tracks labeled, because they said they didn't want me using the word addition, you know, in the thing, you know, because like they have a way to, like, if it's a different version of a song, it's like, you know, insert version here. So you can say it's like, oh, this is the, you know,
blah, live blah, at FuMPFest version, or yeah, Gothsicles, yeah, remix or something.
Yeah. So I had been listing like the like Fanboy and God Wants to Knock You Out. I put 2010 edition because that's what I called them when I put them out at the FuMP and on that album. So they said that, number one, I can't use the word edition because an edition is not a version. What? Okay. And also that you're not allowed to put like calendar years in your version titles or something. It's like, I can't put the year in a thing. What? You know, so, yeah. So, you know, and they also didn't like the fact that for each of the worst tribute ever tracks, I put in there, like, in parentheses, like, worst tribute ever version. Again, I used, or edition, or something like, no,
yeah,
cover. That's what I said. Worst tribute ever cover is what I put in there for each of those tracks, and they didn't like that either. So I had to go and rename a bunch of them, and now I just checked it today to see if it's, you know, if there was anything else that I could tell keeping it from being put out there. And as far as I can tell at the website, it isn't, but I looked at the track listing, and I have two tracks, one that was recorded live at Gen Con and one that was recorded live at a Mars Con, and I originally had the years, but I took the years out. And I am noticing they have changed live at Gen Con and live at Mars Con to just live. And it's like, okay, fine, whatever. As long as the thing comes out, it's like, what? Why? Why
is it a problem? I don't know. And to be fair, most of these rules are not Songcasts. They're probably Spotify's or Apple Music's, yeah, or something like that. But still, it's like they're so,
but like,
stupid.
Just in the history of rock and roll, you know, live in Budapest. It's, yeah, like, that's a thing.
Exactly. What's,
So
anyway.
Yeah.
I figured I would round things out here by just telling everyone, since they can't, because the whole point, the whole timing of all this was supposed to be, I'm going to put it on the FuMP, it'll be up on the FuMP by then, and then I'm going to tell everyone, hey, go check out this collection, it's out on all the places, and it still, as of right now, is still not up everywhere. So once it is up everywhere, I'll tell everyone on my social media, so hopefully it'll be soon, hopefully in the next, like, 2 or 3 days or something. But in case anyone's curious, here is the track listing of Psycho Potpourri excerpts and other stuff. Track one would be Fanboy, the 2010 edition, which here is labeled as the Greatest Hits version. Track two is called This Is Luke Ski's Psycho Potpourri, which incorporates that thing from the radio show I did in college, but I also recorded a about 2 minute or so thing of me. It has bed music to it. The bed music, many will remember, is a track called Are You, that I used to use on Dementia Revolution, which was an awesome track that my brother made when he was a DJ, of like a repeated beat from like the Muppet Show album and some awesome scratching of Weird Al saying the phrase, "Are you?" from the Peter and the Wolf album, and some other like scratching from some other pop records and stuff. And I always loved that track. So I've laid that as the bed music. And then I spent 2 minutes very quickly. I wrote it up in advance so that I wouldn't, you know, be rambling too much, just explaining what the hell this collection is, because my fear is that somebody's going to be like they'll hear of me and they hear of my music and they'll decide, oh, I'll go and I'll listen to his whole discography chronologically. So then they hear this album and this is the first they're ever hearing of my stuff. And I just wanted to explain as quickly as I could what this collection is, and that this was when I was still figuring out how to make comedy music. So some of the music may not be that great, some of the vocals may not be that great, but just hang in there because it gets a lot better, you know, when you get to the later albums. Okay, you know. So anyway, and then it ends with that radio thing, so it leads into the next track. So the next set of tracks are all from either Fanboys in the Hood or Shadows of the Bunghole. There's Hump a Hound, which is, I should clarify, a parody of the House of Pain song Jump Around, which is basically a nonsense song, but it also references Beavis and Butthead, and I impersonate both of them a lot, and that's what that is. Love that bit. And then continuing, my name is Fred, Ron Masao Tome, Cruising USA, and then this is where I put Spam Let the Pork Be Pork, which I labeled here as the FuMP version, which is, I would, you know, on the FuMP I put it as 2023 edition, but that was the version I had. KFC Bitch, Funny Man, The Doctor and William, Murder Was the Play, and quick note about that track, like 2 or 3 weeks ago I was driving around, well actually probably more like a month ago, I was driving around listening to random hip-hop 90s music on Spotify, and then Snoop Dogg's Murder Was the Case came on, and it just started playing, and I was like, fuck, this is the song I should have remade, because like Murder Was the Play is kind of the track that everyone, of the stuff that didn't get remade, that's the one everyone likes the most and thought like, yeah, this is a classic. It ended up on the Greatest Hits collection for sure, because that was the kind of standout track of that early work that didn't get remade. And then hearing Snoop Dogg's original version, it's like, oh man, this could have sounded so awesome. I only would have thought of that a long time ago, but whatever. By then it was too late. I'm like, I got to get this thing done. I can still remake it later if I want to. It's my song. Then continuing, Aliens Just Don't Understand, and then What's Up Spock, and this one is significant because I didn't include the original version of What's Up Spock when I made that Psycho Potpourri compilation disc thingy. So the only way you could have What's Up Spock, the original version, was if you had one of those two CDs that Devo had up a minute ago, and specifically the first one, Fanboys in the Hood. So the original non-remix version of What's Up Spock, followed by Trekkie Case, Thank Q, Gowron Said Knock You Out, the 2010 edition / Greatest Hits version. Then we have One Day at Quark's Bar, Viva Las Vegas, and Quark's New Merchandising Enterprise. And One Day at Quark's Bar and Quark's New Merchandising Enterprise are both sketches I did that take place at Quark's Bar on Deep Space Nine, where I am doing the voices of Quark, Rom, Odo, the Negus, and I can't remember if there's any other characters besides those four, but those four characters are there, and that was to kind of bridging material between some of the other Deep Space Nine related songs when I put out the Trek What You Like compilation. So I always really liked those sketches and thought that they deserve to see the light of day again, so I put them on this collection for that very reason. And you'll also notice that we're in the middle of a long stretch of Star Trek related songs. So, yeah. So after that would be Everyone's Free to Earn Profit, which was live at Gen Con, which is here just listed as live. It was Gen Con 1999 for those keeping track at home. That track was on Trek What You Like, as well as some of my early fan club CDs. Then Fantastic Voyager, and then You Might Be a Trekkie, live at MarsCon 2006, which was on the Greatest Hits collection. But here it's just, again, listed as live because Songcast. Then we get into some of the material that was just, you know, from What a Ripoff Volumes 1, 2, and 3. The first one is basically, I did a track with Ian that was a hidden track at the end of his album, The Last Arcade, that was originally titled A Visit from the Great Luke Ski, where it's me and Ian going through all of these other ideas for songs that he could put in his video game medley compilation.
I love that bit.
Yeah. So we ended it with doing a very short parody of Total Eclipse of the Heart called Playing Some Mario Kart. So it wasn't until later I kind of realized, you know, that bit in and of itself is kind of my first dumb parody idea bit. So I have put just that song part with Insane Ian on this album listed as dumb parody idea number zero. So, because it's the first one ever. So that's what that bit is. Let's see. Then we have Man from Dunder, Skeksis Back, Jabba Jive featuring Carrie Dalby. And this is the version I did where I recorded where I'm singing the lead vocals, just because it's the Great Luke Ski and I wrote the song for Carrie. So she has, there's the version with Carrie doing all the vocals is up at the FuMP and on one of her albums, but I wanted to put the Luke Ski lead vocal version on this collection, which is also how it appeared on the What a Ripoff albums. Star Wars Hanukkah song, speaking of Tom Lehrer, we have Tom Lehrer Sings Public Enemy, which was a follow-up to my track from Target Audience called Public Enemy Sings Tom Lehrer, where Public Enemy sings new math. Is anybody doing new math?
Yes,
I am.
Oh, yeah. No, okay, sorry.
And I'm doing exactly that.
Okay, good.
I mean, it's not going to be Public Enemy, but enemy. Yeah.
Yes. Then we have My Baby's in Love with John Bermuda, and then we have the whole set of tracks from Worst Tribute Ever, and again, rules of Songcast and or Spotify, you're not allowed to put tracks on things that are just called intro. Which Shoebox found out when he tried to put out the Pac-Man EP.
Yeah.
So the track where Dr. Demento introduces Worst Tribute Ever, I have listed that track as Dr. Demento Celebrates the Worst Tribute Ever featuring Dr. Demento. Because I didn't even want to use Dr. Demento Introduces the Worst Tribute Ever because I didn't want to get caught on a technicality for using some form of the word intro. So I said Dr. Demento Celebrates. So, and then we have... from Worst Tribute Ever, You Don't Know Jack, featuring, it's by, You Don't Know Jack by Tony Goldmark, Fangirls Shake That Booty by Scooter Picnic, Titanic Monday by Carrie Dalby, featuring members of the COG, Murder Was the Play by Flat 29, Resistance by Devo Spice, House Party at Arkham Asylum by TV's Kyle, All I Want to Do is Shoot Some Guns by Beth Kenderman and the Player Characters, No Sleep Till Babylon by Soggy Potato Chips, and WFS by Worm Quartet. And I got to say, I was debating whether or not to include that one, but mainly because the original song that is WFS, which is abbreviated for comedy purposes, so that you find out what the song is about when you listen to it. The original version of that song isn't available anywhere else, and I'm kind of fine with that. I didn't mean for it to become... like, you know, for me, you know, sort of a cult classic. But considering that two different people covered it on the Worst Tribute Ever album, I was like, well, I better include at least one of them. And, you know, nothing against, I believe it was Crush Groove and Sea Monkey who did the other version. I just felt like, you know, that this was the more sweeping version that would, you know, go along with the groove here on this particular collection.
Oh, Shoebox's version is brilliant. So
yeah, so because he actually does a fake out at the beginning because he starts playing the piano and you think it's going to be, I assume what he was trying to lean towards was I Have a Love Song Called My Favorite Part, and I think he was trying to fake me out and fake everyone out to think that he was about to do My Favorite Part, and then he goes into WFS, and yeah, it was amazing. So So yeah, and to everybody else who had contributed to that album, who didn't end up on this collection, you ain't shit to me anyway. No, I only said that because that was a line in a Digital Underground song. It's like, to all the rest of you hoes, I forgot about you. Ain't shit to me anyway. But no, it was just, you know, I like I said, this was, you know, meant to be a sampling and not a representative of the whole collection. And I even mentioned on that opening track that. That anyone who wants to hear all of, you know, the complete uncut versions of all of the albums where this stuff came from, they're all still up on my Bandcamp page. So you can all go there and get the whole album. And in fact, like somebody just did today, you can pay $50 and get my entire discography. So you can get all of the versions of all the things there. Oh, and one final track on the album, track number 40, is We Are the FuMP, featuring the Funny Music Project. I decided to stick this one at the end because to me, I'm just super proud of that song and of... how many people we got to be in it. And, you know, 1,000 FuMPs is great too, but 1,000 FuMPs to me was a bit easier of a thing to do because it's like everyone got their two lines and then everyone sang the choruses and that was pretty much it. Figuring out this parody of We Are the World to match, you know, more or less the way all of the original 80s rockers did it so that I had each FuMP person doing a specific, you know, kind of rock person's part and then bringing it all together and then putting in the rap breakdown part that was a part of the We Are the World 25 thing that barely anyone remembers, and just how it also ends on a big crescendo and a like explosion noise and everything. I just felt that was a fitting ending to the collection. Also considering that we just heard all these Worst Tribute Ever tracks by a bunch of my other friends, and then they have this track where we're all together, just seemed to make all the sense in the world. So
We Are the FuMP isn't on any of your albums?
It wasn't. It's on one of the What a Ripoff collections.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't on any of my main albums. So I did put 1,000 FuMPs on Needlessly Meta, just
yeah.
Because I felt it made sense to do so. But for whatever reason at the time, back in when we did We Are the FuMP, I think what would it have been, 2011? So
somewhere in there, yeah.
So yeah, so I don't know why I didn't put it on Worst Tribute, or not, what was it? Be Amused By Me. That was my 2011 album. So
maybe there wasn't room. You do like to cram a lot of crap onto your CDs.
Yeah, there probably wasn't room for it, so it probably made sense just to save it for the next What a Ripoff collection. So yeah, that is all that. That's the whole story behind that. So if anybody wants to take a walk down memory lane, you can eventually, once it's up, go to Spotify or Apple Music or Amazon Music or SoundCloud or YouTube Music and listen to Psycho Potpourri, Excerpts and Other Stuff by the Great Luke Ski, featuring a cast of thousands.
Once Luke figures out the secret code to mastering the titles of the songs that Songcast allows, you'll be able to hear it.
We ran into the same kinds of issues with TuneCore. Chris was tearing his hair out because, you can't say songs from BS to Resistance. Wait, is this a soundtrack album that has to be titled a certain way? And, oh, my God, just little nitpick after nitpick. It was ridiculous. By the way, speaking of Mezzalesto, he did just text me and said, forgot all about it. Neck deep in a studio furniture project. Shit. Oh, well. So
I also we all know Chris well enough to know exactly what you mean when you say
So,
and by the way, Ian was going to be on this evening, but he is working, I assume, on set somewhere, so he wasn't able to make it.
Just text back to him and tell him that he missed the Chris Mezzalesta is awesome tribute episode of the FuMPCast, because that's all we've been talking about the whole time.
Yeah, pretty much.
But anyway, outside of that whole situation I just mentioned, my music is up at lukeski.bandcamp.com, and also all those other song services have all of my other albums except for the one I've just been talking about. Hopefully it'll be up there soon. And thegreatlukeski.com for other Luke Ski information, like the fact that I will be performing at Con in the Cob, my first time performing in Ohio in 10 years, and I need to add that to my tour dates page once I do a Luke Ski update. So, there you go!
Yang. All right, let's do some teasing.
Teasing. He's a teasing kind of guy. Now you have a joke.
Yeah!
Tomorrow's song is by Drew Jacobs. And Tuesday's song is by Joe J. Thomas. And this week's Spotify playlist topic. Now, I took next week off. In fact, next week we may need to do the show on Wednesday night because I don't think I'm going to be around on Thursday. But we can talk about that offline. So I was thinking of making the Spotify playlist topic vacations. Are there a lot of vacation songs? I know there was one that was nominated for a Logan.
I'm on vacation by Rhett and Link.
Rhett and Link, that's who it was.
There's also You're Going to the Dells by Me.
Right.
There's a song, that's probably not on Spotify. I was thinking of Tony Goldmark's Disney World song. Kingdom in the Sky by Da Vinci's Notebook is about Disney World. Vacation. Hello Mudda, Hello Fada could sort of be considered a vacation.
Sure. Biggest Ball of Twine.
I was just going to say that. Yes, right. Yes.
Oh, there's a song.
Ian, apparently, Sci Fantasy in the chat says Vacation Road by Insane Ian.
Yeah, a parody of Holiday Road about Mad Max.
Which gets stuck in my head for months at a time.
There's a song I want to look up. I'm going to look up who it's by because I know Dr. Mendo has played it a bunch, called the $300 Vacation.
Oh, yeah. I remember hearing that. That was a sketch, wasn't it?
No, well, I mean, it was. There's music behind it, but it's mainly a guy speaking, telling the story. I'll just put in the word vacation.
But Tom Lehrer's I Want to Go Back to Dixie, although it's not strictly vacation. It's more
Virgil,
travel.
Virgil and the $300 Vacation by Cletus Maggard. Let's see what else is on here, as long as I've done a search for that word that jumps out as being awesome. Brax Hawaiian Vacation, which is listed as being by Space Ghost.
I'm going to search the FuMP for the word vacation, see what comes up. Oh, only four songs. Claustrophobia by Smashy Claw, which I don't know why that showed up. Douche and Flip Flops by Undercover Funtime, which is one of my favorite songs on the FuMP. So that's going on there. Rent Boy by Robert London Spaff and Virtual Road Trip by Grottomatic are the only four that showed up. But I think I have enough. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yep, I have enough tracks, assuming they're all on Spotify. So cool. Thank you.
If you need an alternate, there's How I Spent My Summer Vacation or A Day at the Beach with Pedro and Man Part 1 by Cheech and Chong.
Yeah, I don't like that track.
I only mentioned it in case you needed another one. I'm not huge on that track either.
I like Cheech and Chong. I just I find that one annoying and way too long. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just me.
How much of Cheech and Chong's entire discography is just them saying the word man back and forth to each other?
I haven't listened to their stuff in so long, I couldn't even tell you. But
I actually saw them like 2020, 21, something like that. They were at a casino in Washington, D.C. And it was a lot of fun, and they did all the musical numbers in between. Yeah, it was great.
They make a cameo in The Muppets Mayhem. That's
yes.
Awesome.
With, yeah. So good.
That's a A+ product placement there for sure.
Yes,
for the parents that are watching the movie stoned, and it's like, yeah, hey, there you go. I was a stay at home dad. I know these things.
All right, so Dale, plug yourself one more time.
All right, so the Suffolk and Goode Players Bandcamp site is sagplayers.bandcamp.com, which has not only our new album, but also the new single that you heard tonight, Re-Indicted. The podcast is My Friend Lisa, L-Y-S-S-A. Going strong. We're recording another episode next week with lots of fun and more music. Yeah, that's about it.
Mike, plug yourself one more time.
You can find me at twitch.tv/twosleepsmusic or twosleepsmusic.com.
Luke, plug yourself one more time.
Well, the thing I would be plugging would have been the brand new Lukeski Top 50 poll, which has been on my calendar for 5 months, but I can't because the Psychopulpery collection isn't up on the thing yet. So I have to put that off until, you know, another couple of weeks down the road. But I'll mention the fact that I do intend to do the updated Lukeski Top 50 poll for the purpose of taking all the tracks from my latest album, Needlessly Meta, and adding them into the mix to see where they rank amongst all of the other songs I've done in my entire comedy music career. So I would like to encourage everyone, if you're looking for something to listen to on all of those streaming services, you can listen to my entire discography again and get yourself all refreshed in the brain, especially with the newest album, Needlessly Meta, so that when that comes along in a couple of weeks, you can know which tracks to vote for. And as I said before, my website is thegreatlukeski.com, and you can hear my music at all those other places, and also lukeski.bandcamp.com if you're the kind of person who's actually willing to spend money on art made by people.
All righty, let's get out of here. Thank you for listening to the Funny Music Podcast. I'm Devo Spice.
I'm Luke Ski. And look, there's Two Sleeps.
I'm Two Sleeps.
Yep. And there's Dale from Suffolk Goode.
Yep. Thank you for listening to the Funny Music Podcast. You can listen live every Thursday night at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific at DementiaRadio.org and join us in the chat or subscribe to the podcast feed. Look us up on iTunes and be sure to leave us a review. Feedback for the show can be sent to info@thefump.com. The Funny Music Podcast is a production of FIDEM Interactive, LLC, released under a Creative Commons share-alike license. Tell your friends. Tell your enemies. Shout it to random people on the street. And be sure to visit thefump.com for the latest funny songs. Tune in next week where you'll hear Luke Ski say,
I saw a bunny! I saw a bunny! It's hopping!